David, welcome to Waterstones.
Thanks for having me.
It's quite a sobering read, and there's a lot of information quite near the beginning of the book, actually, which I found to be very, very effective in explaining just how bad climate change really is. But what also struck me is that in order for us to do anything about it, we need everybody involved. And of course, there are huge swathes of people who just deny that this is actually a thing. What can you say to them to convince them that it is a problem and that we need to do something about it?
Well, for me, I think extreme weather is already teaching them quite powerfully. The unprecedented heat wave last year, all of the wildfires that we've seen in California, hurricane after hurricane in the Caribbean. We just had the first February typhoon in the Pacific in history. And I do think that the public opinion is moving there actually quite dramatically as a result. So I know the American case best, but 73% of Americans now believe that climate change is real and happening now. That means 27% don't, which is probably too high. I wish it were smaller. But 26% of Americans believe that aliens live among us. So I think we're actually at a point already now where denial, while too big, is small enough that we shouldn't let it have a veto over our collective action. The question is why fossil fuel interests and skepticism in general has a hold on our policymakers. And I think that is a bit of a different question. I think it has to do in part with direct reliance on money from people who have an incentive to not take action on the problem. But I also think it's because we generally, and in particular in our politics, have a kind of status quo bias where we don't want to take action. And because up until quite recently, there was economic conventional wisdom that suggested that action on climate would be very expensive. That logic has actually been reversed just in the past few years. Most economists, if you ask them now, would say it'll be much better for us economically to take action faster rather than slower. I think policymakers haven't yet adjusted to that new conventional wisdom, but when they do, I think we'll see much more action, and we'll see the force of deniers shrink quite radically, especially as we enter into more and more extreme weather. We see more wildfires, we see more hurricanes, we see more droughts and famines. I think it'll just become hard to look at the world and not recognize that it's changing. There are all these other impacts, though, beyond the direct impacts that I think we haven't yet really begun to reckon with, even those of us who take climate change seriously. I think our politics is already being shaped by intuitions of resource scarcity. I think that will continue in the decades ahead. I think our culture, too, the way that we relate to technology has changed, the way we relate to capitalism has changed, and will continue to change. And those are some of the non-scientific subjects that I tackle in the book, not just what climate change will do to us, but what it will mean for the way that we live in this new, transformed, in most cases, deformed world.
I think anybody finishing the book will feel sort of empowered to do something about it. And so I guess the simplest question is, what can an ordinary person like you or I do in their everyday life to actually make a difference? Because whilst we wait for the people in power to effect big change, what can we do?
I think there are a number of features of our lives that have carbon footprints, actually practically every feature of our life. So how much electricity we use, how much we drive, how much we fly, what we eat, all of these things we can relate to more responsibly and behave in ways that make our own carbon footprints smaller. But ultimately, I think that the policy is by far the most important driver. I think we won't get to a stable, livable planet just because a number of well-intentioned people, especially in the wealthy West, decided to eat a few less hamburgers a year. I just don't think that adds up to much. What we need is our governments to prioritize this at the highest level. And ultimately, that's up to us. We live in at least representative democracies. We can make those voices heard even beyond how we vote, through protest, through organization. And again, I see actually great optimism there, great reason for hope. I think that grassroots movements have been moving very quickly over the last few years. And the number of people who are more concerned about this than they were 10 years ago, that number is astronomical. We now have to leverage that into policy, and we need to put pressure on our leaders not just to make rhetorical gestures about climate, but to really commit to climate change as the overarching, all-governing political challenge of our time, and to orient all of our policy in that direction. Because no matter what you care about in this world politically, no matter what you want to see happen, it will be affected in some way by climate change. And that means that if we want to, say, address wealth creation or income inequality, if we want to address, conflict, violence against women, drought, famine, social instability, absolutely everything that you might care about in the world is impacted by climate. If you want to take action on those issues, we need to solve climate change first. Otherwise, we'll have very little hope of doing what we can on those other metrics. So I think we really need to think of climate as a top order political priority and make our leaders behave as though it is.
It's a very empowering message, as I said, David, and thank you for doing the work of, I guess, assembling all of this information and putting it in such an accessible book. It's a powerful read and a very sobering one, so thank you.
Thank you for having me. Great to talk to you.